I'd like to call to order the Budget Committee. We have a hearing today on the California Forward, but before we get to that, we want to do a couple of things. First, we've got a number of vehicles that are vote-only items. They're technical amendments to numerous budget vehicles that we'll take up on the floor next week. Eventually, these bills will contain specific provisions for the 2010-11 budget package. So what I'd like to do is basically call the roll for AB 1610, and I'm going to recommend do pass as amended on AB 1610. So clerk, would you call the roll on that bill? Do I need a motion for that? I need a motion for do pass as amended. It's been moved. It's a technical amendment. No, we have to make the motion first. Oh, we need a quorum call. Apologize. Thank you. First thing we're going to do is have a quorum call.
Blumenfield?
Here.
Nielsen?
Here.
Adams?
Okay, a quorum has been established. Budget Committee is now officially in session. Next procedural thing is to have a recommendation. I'm recommending a do pass as amended on AB 1610. Mr. Ruskin has moved. Is there a second?
Second.
Mr. Bell, second.
Would this include the entire amendment? All the vehicles, or are you going to take a vote on each?
The question is, what I've been informed is we're going to vote on the first one, and then we're going to ask if there's an objection to substituting the roll on all of them. So we're not going to go through each one individually.
And I might note respectfully.
You turn your mic on.
Get an abstention on the vote, or if a member feels that they would want to vote an aye or nay, that'd be okay with, or as far as Republicans, but I have a reluctance to advocate for a vote for something in process. We have no idea what it's all about. So we'd be abstaining, but we might have a member who wants to make a vote, but that's okay.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you. Please call the roll.
Blumenfield?
Aye.
Nielsen? Adams? Arambula?
Aye.
Arambula, aye. Bell?
Aye.
Bell, aye. Berryhill? Brownlee? Buchanan? Caballero? Carter? Carter, aye. Chesbro?
Aye.
Chesbro, aye. Cook? De La Torre?
Here,
aye. De La Torre, aye. Emerson?
Both are true.
Evans? Fuhr? Fuhr, aye. Fuller? Bertani?
Aye.
Bertani, aye. Gilmore? Harkey? Huffman? Jeffries? Jones? Nastandi? Ruskin?
Yes.
Ruskin, aye. Silva? Swanson?
Swanson, aye.
Swanson, aye.
Okay, we have 11-4, so we will keep the roll open on that. So I will wait for the other ones until we have more members present. With that, let me get into the logistics of today. What we're going to be doing is a couple of things. We'll be working. Today's basically, it's part of a four-part discussion about California Forward's proposal. I'm going to make some logistical remarks. Specifically, we're working on from a document prepared from the committee that's titled Overview of the California Forward Proposal. As you all know, the California Forward Plan is complex, multifaceted, but basically we've split it into two vehicles, ACA 4 and AB 2591. The document in front of you helps break up the proposal so that we can focus our discussion on each element of the California Forward proposal. Specifically, I want to call your attention to page 2. This lists all the elements of the California Forward proposal. If you continue to page 3, you can see how these items are scheduled for discussion. We are going to get to every item throughout these various hearings, trying to keep just order and limiting what we look at and when we look at it. So we've grouped these by points into 8 different agendas, and today we're considering specifically issues 1 through 3, which starts on page 4. So we'll start today's discussion on page 4. With that, just a few comments. You know, I'm here, this is my first term, my third hearing as chair, and I don't want to be here in 5 years from now where we're going through the same old thing again and again with the same budget stalemates and the same problems. So that's one of the reasons I'm optimistic about this kind of thing, where we can move forward, we can move California forward with some real reform, so that in 5 years from now, when me and the other rest of the freshman class, we can look back and say, you know, not only do we have balanced budgets and hopefully surpluses, but we actually have a process that works better and is more effective. You know, we don't want to be locked in the chambers again late at night trying to figure this out. We want a process that's transparent, open, fiscally smart, and that ultimately does right by all of Californians. And I'm confident that every member of this committee on both sides of the aisle shares that general vision. So it's with that lens that we're really trying to fix our broken process and move us forward. So with that, I want to ask the vice chair if he has any comments before we begin today, or to offer you that up.
Mr. Chairman, indeed, I laud your resolve, and we all want to have leave here several years hence having accomplished a number of things. And there's always merit in reviewing things. There's certain aspects of this that, you know, might have some problems with, but it's certainly all open for discussion, and we look forward to proceeding.
Great, thank you. So if I could call up the witnesses. And I guess I want to add one other comment. Is, you know, the way I look at this proposal and as we look at it, I see this as a package. It's not so much a menu. You know, there are things, and we're going to go through them, that I like very much, and there's some things, quite frankly, that I don't like at all. But one of my favorite political expressions goes back, some people attribute it to Mark Twain, but it goes back to Voltaire. And it's the perfect is often the enemy of the good. And what I'm hopeful is that I know that this proposal in my mind is not perfect, and I doubt that it's perfect in anyone's mind who's sitting here. I hope that we can at least move something forward that's good, and that we can look at this package and not sort of, we need to go through every item of it, but we won't pick it apart as a menu, but we'll look at it at the end in its totality as a package. So with that, we have everyone here now. I was stalling while you guys got up, and we're all here now. So why don't we have the members of the panel introduce themselves for starters. Let's start with Mr. Hawk, and then.
Mr. Chairman, I'm Bill Hawk. I'm a member of the California Forward Leadership Council, which essentially is the governing board of California Forward.
I'm Dr. Denzel Verardo. I'm an advisor to California Forward, and I'm a commissioner on the Senate Advisory Commission for Cost Control and State Government.
I'm Ernie Powell, Manager of Advocacy for AARP California State Office.
And Fred Silva, Fiscal Policy Advisor to California Forward.
And who is the man at the podium?
I don't know, but I'm Mike Feuer.
And the author of the bill. So we start with your comments and open.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair, colleagues. I'm going to deliver just a few prefatory remarks and then have us dive into the details of the three elements of the package that are on the table for this afternoon's conversation. Let me describe the process that we've been going through for a moment. Some of you have been engaged in the reform effort that was convened by both houses starting in September. There were meetings throughout the fall bipartisan, bicameral sessions of committees to improve state government from the Senate and from the Assembly. We met throughout the state of California on multiple occasions, the result of which is a package that is comprehensive and balanced and practical at the same time. Some of the elements that emerged from our reform effort are not before us today or in the next few weeks, because we put together a series of significant changes in how this House does business that will take effect without need to go to the ballot. In addition, there is a package of changes to how we engage in the budget process in particular that's before us now that emerged from our work and then a melding, essentially, of our work, given the California Forward's focus has been on very similar issues. The decision has been made by many of us that it's really important, as our chair has indicated, to have this comprehensive bipartisan package presented as a whole. For today, we're talking about several elements of that package. But to be sure we're on the same page, the comprehensive package includes elements we'll be addressing in future meetings. Those elements include establishing a pay-as-you-go regime, not only for legislation, but also for initiatives that will be brought to the voters. If there's going to be a major change in a program or the creation of a new one, a significant amount, we should show where the funding is going to come from for that. If an initiative is proposing a new program or an expanded program, the voters should have at their disposal the funding for that before they vote on it. Other elements besides pay-as-you-go, looking at non-recurring revenues in a different way, looking at revenues one-time revenues, one-time purposes, establishing a more rigorous schedule for getting budgets done. I think in each of our districts, everybody knows that when we go back home to our districts, perhaps the biggest concern voters have is get the budget done on time. And there are elements in this package we'll discuss that facilitate getting the budget done on time. If there's a fiscal emergency, the package includes how the governor can deal with that, essentially saying that if we don't address a fiscal emergency within 45 days, the governor has expanded powers. I will say parenthetically, if we don't address a fiscal emergency in 45 days, we don't deserve to serve in this House. Vote thresholds would change under this. If you're going to replace a pre-existing tax with a fee, the vote threshold would be two-thirds. If the budget is before us all, as opposed to the current system of two-thirds being required for the budget, not for revenues, but for the budget itself, we would move to in the direction of almost every state in the country to a majority vote for a budget whose process reflects the ideas I mentioned that are the product of a bipartisan deliberation. And now for today. For today, we're going to be addressing three particular elements of the proposal. Requiring performance-based budgeting be the method by which we determine how to allocate our scarce funds in the state. Requiring a rigorous program evaluation system exist here in the state legislature, and having the governor provide to us enough information so we can engage in meaningful long-term thinking by giving us a budget not only for a given fiscal year, but showing us what it would look like for the next fiscal year and projecting forward as well. So at the end of the day, our process reflects meaningful long-term thinking that for which we are accountable and, as Mr. Chair indicated, which is transparent. Now, as to the details, I will defer to the witnesses to discuss the specific elements of each of these components: performance-based budgeting, rigorous program evaluation, and the method by which the governor presents a budget to us. But I, as well as our witnesses, are available to answer any questions at all. Bottom line, we have a moment in time. The moment is now, in which we will either consign future generations of leaders in the state, and therefore everyone in the state, to the vicissitudes of budget crises up and down every year, again and again, an appearance of dysfunction, or we can find ways to be as prudent as we can with other people's money and advance the state. And with that, I'd like to turn to our first witness, Bill Houck, who, as you know, leads the Business Roundtable and is also a member of California Forward's Leadership Council, for some preliminary remarks, and then we'll have other witnesses at the chair's leave, we'll have questions and so on. Mr. Houck, please.
Thank you, Mr. Fuhrer. Mr. Chairman, members, thank you for the opportunity to be here today. My remarks will be quite brief. I'd say first, I want to associate myself with the remarks of the chairman as well as Mr. Fuhrer with respect to the work that we've engaged in at California Forward. Essentially, at least in our view, California has a budget process which might have been appropriate for the 19th century, but is certainly not appropriate for the 21st century. And frankly, I don't know any other organization, either public or private, that handles its budget the way the state of California currently handles its budget. Essentially, the governor proposes the budget. You consider it over a long period of time. You enact the budget and then walk away from it, by and large, with respect to any action, for the next 12 months. You all know that that doesn't work anymore. The world is much more volatile. Things are much different, much more complex today in California, and the demands on the state's resources are so much greater than they once were. And let me emphasize the point that Mr. Fuhrer made. When you have scarce funds and scarce resources, as you do, that makes looking at whether programs you're financing are working even more important than they might have been prior to that time. I would also argue that California will always have scarce resources, even in good times, because more legitimate demands can always be presented to you than you can meet. And as a consequence, you've got to have the ability to prioritize the spending that you're going to do in any given year or two-year period against your most important programs. And you want to be sure that those programs are working. You don't want to evaluate them on the basis of how much you gave them last year and how much you want to add to them this year, if you're in a position where you indeed can actually add to any particular program. The way we went about this really was to stand back from the process and say, what do we need to do here? And it's not unlike, I would argue, what needs to be done in a number of the schools, a number of our public schools in the state, and then indeed what is actually being done in a number of those schools. We need an entire transformation in the way the budget is handled in California. And we need you to begin to think in those terms, rather than evaluating proposals like this or any others against what you have done for years and years and years. Evaluate them against what will work for California today and tomorrow. In many, or in any number of California schools today in California that are perpetually low and non-performing schools, personnel in those schools are standing back from that situation, asking themselves what they need to do to bring the children that are in those schools up to the state's standards, and they're proceeding to do it. They're not waiting for any of you to tell them what to do. They're not waiting for anyone in the Department of Education to tell them what to do. They can see right in front of them what needs to be done, and the good news is there are any number of them that are actually getting it done and bringing kids up to a level of proficiency that will permit them to be competitive, either whether they go to work or whether they decide to go on to college. And that's essentially the same thing that we are now asking you to do. Take yourselves out of the traditional way of thinking about the way this has been done and think about what will work for you today. Other states have done this reasonably successfully, and that will be discussed today. So we appreciate your willingness to engage in this discussion, your willingness to listen. I'm not the expert on this subject, but we do have experts that are here today. Denzel is an expert on performance budgeting. Fred Silva, whom I'm sure some of you know, was involved in the budget process here in this building for many years, and Ernie is a spokesman for AARP. So I'm going to turn this, or Mr. Feuer, back to you. Denzel is next in our lineup.
Mr. Chair, if I might say one more thing before we hear from our California Forward expert on performance-based budgeting. I did not say this at the inception of my remarks because I wanted to hear Mr. Houck. But let me share with you. In the first hearing our reform committees held months ago now, Mr. Houck came and offered testimony. And I want to frame this bipartisan set of recommendations before us today with something he said. In 1994, the state was grappling with what to that point was the biggest financial crisis we had ever confronted. Governor Wilson was in office at the time. There was convened at that moment a constitutional revision commission to address what were perceived to be systemic problems with our budgeting and other processes. Its chair was Mr. Houck. He warned us at our first meeting months ago that we cannot replicate what took place then. 2 years' worth of solid work by many of the state's leading experts culminated in 1996 with a presentation by that commission to a subsequent legislature. In the main, those recommendations remained recommendations. Why? Because the crisis had passed, and the impetus to make major changes had passed with it. Mr. Howe came to our first hearing and admonished us not to let this opportunity posed by this crisis pass again. So it's with that in mind that I would like to turn over to our next witness from California Forward on performance-based budgeting. And Mr. Chair, again, at your leave, however you like this presentation to proceed, we're happy to do so.
Go ahead, Mr. Happ.
Good morning again. A little background on my expert witness capabilities with performance budgeting. I was in charge of the state parks team from 1994 to 1999 that led the performance budget pilot in the state of California for state parks. From 1999 until 2003, we continued with performance measurement effort, even though the performance budget pilot itself was no longer in place. And as chief deputy director, I led the effort on performance measurement and management implementation. When I retired from state parks, I then went back to work briefly for a year and a half on the California Performance Review as a member of the budget team and then the implementation team for the performance review on performance budget implementation and performance measurement management implementation. So I wanted to give you that background first before I go into why performance budgeting works. And first of all, in the state of California, in the performance budget pilots, state parks was successful. Now, you may hear, and I notice even in the staff recommendations, they say it was abandoned. Well, the legislature and the administration didn't move forward adopting performance-based budgeting. But California State Parks indeed made a successful effort at it, and in fact, for two fiscal years, had a demonstration performance budget in the governor's budget. Now, why does it work? Let me give you a brief synopsis of the state park story. In 1994, we were arguably one of the worst administered government agencies in California. And I was there then, so it's not like I'm slamming a previous department. So we instituted and wanted to take performance budgeting because it would help us identify what we're doing with core programs, how to measure it and turn it into actionable dollars and cents that we could see what we were doing exactly with the public's money. Well, from 1994 being the worst, in 1997, California State Parks was awarded the Malcolm Baldrige Award by the California Quality Award in California as best in class in the government category, and that includes all governments in California. In 2000, we were the only government agency ever in the United States of America to be awarded an Arthur Andersen Best Practices Award. Performance measurement management was primarily the reason for that dramatic improvement in the way we managed. And in fact, what's in it for department executives is, frankly, I don't know how I ever managed without it, but we do. And the reason we manage without it is because the current budget, even as the deputy director for administration, if I pick up the budget today and look at state parks or any department, I was also with the Department of Alcohol and Drug Programs, it doesn't tell you what we do. You know, it tells you the money that goes in, it tells you the money that goes out, but when you open it up, It doesn't tell you anything. Your staff meets with department staff sometime. Department of Finance tries to figure out what departments are doing. And even then, what you're getting from departments is a filtered explanation of what's done. While you try to protect our budget and while you try to figure out how we're going to save. Performance budgeting takes that away because it splays open the budget system and shows you exactly what departments do. And we splayed ourselves open during 1994 to 1999 so that you, the policymakers, could ask us the hard questions, because unfortunately, performance measures are just how you're performing. It's not all good news. The State Park story on the measurement system showed that we were not doing well in several areas, and that's where the dialogue needed to take place. What's in it for you? It's an absolutely incredible tool to gauge the effectiveness of departments and agencies instead of the current process. It also has some peril for you, and I'll be honest about it, because when you cut a department, you will know exactly where those cuts are going to go based on a performance budget. You'll know the impact of it. Currently, if you do an across-the-board cut, it's pretty much up to the department to figure out where they're going to cut, and that's not necessarily the people's priorities. So the peril is, you know, you will have to go back to your constituents and explain, with these cuts, we looked at the metrics, and this was the best decision we could make. There's something else that I noticed in the staff comment that I want to make one note of. It says, the use of performance measures can narrow the focus and objectives of departments too much on the measurable performance, resulting in a loss of focus in other areas that are important but not measured. Important but not measured? Every department I'm in, I said, if we couldn't measure what you're doing, your salary savings. I mean, if you can't measure it, you can't manage it. I can't think of anything that can't be measured. Now, you know, some of it might be tangential, some of it might not be hard data till you get the data systems going, but frankly, that's baloney. You have to be able to measure what departments do. The most important part of performance budgeting, performance measurement system, is accountability to the public. It needs to go up on departments' websites. I believe State Park still has the 2004 report up on its website that was developed in 2003. They deserve to see what's being done with the resources that they're providing as taxpayers. And currently, you can't see where those dollars are going. So, as you can tell, I'm an advocate both for performance budgeting and performance measurement. It will not take long to implement. The timelines in the legislation are perfectly acceptable. And in fact, how much is it going to cost to develop a guide to developing performance measures? It already exists. The Performance Review developed a handbook and training slides to go with it that was adopted by several departments. It wasn't mandated. It was voluntary. But the packet exists to develop performance measurement right now. Thank you very much.
I'm going to ask the other panelists, keep in mind that we have three different discussion topics. This topic is, and you're right on performance-based budgeting. So I'm going to ask the other panelists if they have testimony on performance-based budgeting, knowing that we have performance management and budget information coming up afterwards. So are there any additional testimony on performance-based budgeting? And then we'll move to members' questions and discussion.
Well, I have a set of remarks which I think takes to cover that topic that you're asking for, Mr. Chairman.
Please go ahead. I was just trying to keep us focused on the specific topic. Go ahead.
I appreciate that. My name is Ernie Powell. I'm Senior Manager of Advocacy for AARP California, and it's a pleasure to be here representing 3.2 million AARP members throughout California. And we're here to urge you to enact budget reforms that over time will improve the quality, access, and reliability to the vital services that Californians, in particular older Californians, rely on. The feast or famine system we have today has hurt health, social, and transit programs the most. In the long run, some fiscal discipline is needed to protect California's most vulnerable residents from the vagaries of the business cycle and a budget process in which they are the first hurt and the last to recover. In addition, the budget debate must be about results and not just spending. The budget process is usually a fight to defend or expand programs, seldom to improve them. And without a focus on results, it is hard for you as policymakers or residents and taxpayers to know what choices are actually being made and what value we receive. AARP supports California Forward's fiscal reforms because they would significantly advance both goals, stability and results. The individual provisions are largely based on best practices of other states, states that were in better shape going into the economic crisis and have been able to manage the crisis with few impacts or essential services. Some of the specific measures, such as the enacting a budget with a simple majority while keeping the two-thirds vote to raise taxes, these are reasonable compromises given the fiscal discipline measures that are also included in this set of reforms. Most of all, AARP supports California Forward's mission to develop the best possible solutions through inclusive public discussions and by building broad coalitions that will support well-reasoned policy changes. We proudly count ourselves as partners in this coalition. This proposal is a first step toward government that is closer to the people. California has become too big, too complex, and too diverse to be micromanaged from Sacramento. People yearn for a government they have confidence in, one they can see, touch, and complain to when that's appropriate. Let me close with this. It troubles us greatly that at AARP to hear that California has become ungovernable, or to hear of the large majority of Californians who feel the state is on the wrong track. Our members are engaged, our members are concerned, and they feel disconnected. Our members believe there is a chronic disconnect between government and the people it services. People have no confidence in a bureaucracy they see as distant, disinterested, and unable to solve problems and address their concerns. It simply does not work. Our AARP members have spoken loud and clear. They all say the same thing. They love our state, they're proud of our state, but something has gone seriously wrong and someone has to fix it. With these proposals and through bipartisan deliberations and compromises, you can prove that California again can be governed. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll start with a question about, you know, a lot of people know about the California performance-based budgeting pilot. How is the California Forward's proposal different than that? How is it superior to that?
I think California Forward's proposal mirrors what was the experience of the pilots with asking for a performance-based budget and a tie to performance measures, management, and strategic planning. That's really the complete performance management system. Even without performance budgeting, departments of government should be doing performance measurement and strategic planning. It's an essential component. So those two items can be done separately, but together they make a complete unit.
Mr. Chair, if I might also add, in our hearings throughout the course of the fall, we took up that question. And one of the answers that was expressed by witness after witness, including those from outside the state who were following that previous experiment, is there was not sufficient buy-in throughout every level of government for that program to be expanded beyond where it was. And the difference, I think, between this proposal, which is also more specific, but this proposal and previous ones is this sends a message, ideally, that the people of the state demand this approach. And it thrusts upon the legislature and the executive branch the necessity of identifying performance metrics that will really work for all of us and ask, I think, ultimately a question that all of us need to be asking in an era of scarce resources. And that is not merely, is this program doing what it's supposed to do? And not merely is it cost effective, but is it promoting the most important goals of the state? That was not present previously and can be with this proposal.
One other item that I think is important. There was no direction given to the pilot departments in 1994 that started. So they all took different performance budget paths. With state parks, we got lucky in choosing a path that others had used that worked. But the departments that fell out of the pilot had chosen a path that led basically to a dead end in performance budgeting. We don't have to reinvent those mistakes anymore. Both the performance review and what we've learned from the pilot show that we can do it. The other big reason it failed, state parks at that time was 0.3% of 1% of the state budget. There was no way a minor department from a budget standpoint was going to change the California budget system. It has to be a much broader base.
Yeah, I think that was certainly part of it, and it's hard. It's going to be harder to game the system if it's done system-wide than if you have just one pilot program where some of the bureaucrats there may feel like can wait it out and see what happens, as opposed to if it's going across. I've got a bunch of questions, but I want to open up to members. Mr. Nastandi, start.
Thank you, and I apologize. I had to step out for a minute. It sounds like you may have touched on one of my questions. Is how do you hold people accountable if you're performance-based? Who does the manager get to fire people, but you have collective bargaining agreements? How does all that work? If you're really going to measure performance, how do you follow through with it? Second part of it, if I may, is in, I believe, other states, they allow competing outside groups to come in and compete with departments and projects within the departments, and the government organization competes against a private sector company. They can come in and give different proposals and see who wins. And that's a good way to check on performance by also or having a competition factor in there. Thank you.
First on the accountability. An ideal performance budget and performance management system, let me say what we did in state parks and in some departments that I'm currently working with. The performance measure system is broken down, let me use parks as an example because most departments are structured the same, to our district superintendents. So they had their piece of the pie. For instance, whatever the targets were supposed to be in resource protection and management, they had a piece of that, and each district superintendent had a contract with the deputy director for operations. At the end of the year, that contract was evaluated, and basically their raises were based on their performance or lack of raise or, in a couple of cases, removal for non-performance with the public's money. So the accountability factor goes from management to the next level of management down. Now, the other thing we found is you could do some tremendous savings when the performance measures tell you that. When we were implementing performance budgeting, we were cut $10 million. 1994 was a bad budget year. Well, bad budget year. I think while I was with State Parks for 32 years, I think we had one good year in a row. But 1994 was a pretty awful time. So we were cut $10 million at the same time we were doing the implementation. So accountability had to be held at the managerial levels. That's what managers are for.
Okay, but my question, one quick second, is below the managerial level, are you giving the managers tools to manage?
Absolutely. We were both giving resources were divided with discretion at the district superintendent level so that they could work with their staff and figure out how to adjust resources when the measurement system showed if law enforcement wasn't doing as well as should or the crime rate was going up, they could move resources from resource protection into it and vice versa. They were rewarded for those kinds of decisions. But the whole staff was a team-based approach, which didn't occur before then. And again, we were uniformed, so getting a team-based approach in a hierarchy that is basically police was difficult to do at first, but then everybody loved it when they're part of the decision-making process. Most government employees want to do well. I mean, sure, you have some managers that need to be taken care of, and it's our job to take care of them when you're an executive. But most state employees, if you level the playing field, are every bit as good as their private counterparts.
Mr. Sandy, very quickly, there are two in this package, there are at least two methods of holding departments accountable for their delivery of service. One is, as was said, the budget itself. There'll be a diminution in resources or a shift in them if there are problems that are not being addressed properly within a department. Secondly, the next thing we'll talk about is program evaluation. And this proposal is a requirement that we evaluate each program in state government over the course of time that complements the performance-based budgeting that takes place annually. And the program is agnostic about competition for service delivery. It doesn't say one way or the other who can compete for that service delivery, but it's designed to help enhance the tools decision makers have as we make tough choices.
It sounds good, but in reality, are you really going to defund foster care? Because if the program's not going well, are you going to pull the money from foster care? No.
Well, so I think
which part of the budget are we going to yank money from
Well, let me say, this is not about, I would say, and this might disagree, performance-based budgeting is not a tool to cut government necessarily, nor to increase government. It's a tool that enables us as decision makers to be more thoughtful and knowledgeable about the tough choices we confront. And indeed, if we find a program is not performing in the way it should, and this program includes within it the requirement of substantial metrics, what are you supposed to do, measured against, what are you doing? If that's not functioning properly, it's up to us to decide what to do. It really makes us more accountable as leaders ourselves.
In fact, I would argue we might then, if in a situation like that, move that program from one agency to another when we found it wasn't effective, or take corrective action like that. Next on the list was Mr. Rambila, followed by Mr. Chespero.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Feer, I want to commend you for all of the hard work you've put into this. It's my observation, I'm in my sixth year in the Assembly, and it's my observation, having participated in various budget subcommittees over that period, that the legislature as a whole has really been derelict in terms of a systemic oversight or involvement in a meaningful way with regard to budget. Oftentimes, members are elected and they come so that they can introduce bills and then go back home with a little score sheet and say, look at all of the bills I passed. But the other half of our job, I believe, should be to be doing systematic reviews of laws that are already passed and to review the operation of the administrative branch, because oftentimes we allow the administration to get by with failures of computer systems or cost overruns or a request for augmentation. It's almost like it's a black box and we don't know what goes on in there, and we don't take the time to ask those questions. It's almost as if the BBs are in charge, and I describe the BBs as those that say, I be here before you and I be here after you. I'm a strong fan of performance budgeting. Some years ago, I asked a department that shall remain unnamed for an evaluation of funds they had distributed for economic development. And I asked for the evaluation because I wanted to know, is this something that I wanted to be involved with, seeking an extension or an expansion? I was given a one-page sheet, and it showed who the money went to. And that was the extent of the evaluation. I believe you're absolutely right. It's all about choices. And we can't make choices if we don't have the information. And I believe that this approach will provide that information.
Mr. Chesbrough, followed by Ms. Buchanan.
Yes, I was struck and somewhat alarmed by a comment a few moments ago that if you can't, I'm reinterpreting it somewhat, but if you can't measure it, then we shouldn't be doing it. And I think if that is an underlying concept of performance-based budgeting, it seems like we're very much at risk of having the less tangible, harder to measure, but nonetheless extremely important functions of government lose at the expense of the things that are easier to measure. And I'll give you some examples that come to mind. What is the tangible measurement of an endangered species that doesn't go extinct? Or increment of independent of life quality of independent living for a person with a severe disability, being able to live in a more independent setting than an institutional setting? What is the tangible, measurable part of that part of education which has admittedly suffered in recent years, but education for our young people includes the arts, so that you have a well-rounded person and that doesn't respond. And we can see, I think, in our performance requirements in education how those less tangible things have suffered because they don't carry the same measurable, tangible value in the economy that we know that mathematics and literacy do. So a fear that I have of us putting too much emphasis, and I'm not indicting the whole concept, but a fear that I have of putting too much emphasis on this measurement business is that we lose track of some of our very real obligations, or at least obligations that I feel as a legislator, to have government respond to things that that don't easily get put on a measurable list, don't have increments that are easy to identify as measurable. That's my first question. I have another one. I appreciate a response to that.
Mr. Chesbrough, let me respond by saying it may be that the word evaluate would be better than a strict metric or a strict number that you could apply to a program, but when you all are looking at any particular budget, what are you asking yourselves? Are you asking yourselves, let's see, these folks spent $50 million last year, and they're asking for $55 million this year. What are you going to do with that money? That's what you normally do. You're not asking them you're not evaluating how they spent the $50 million. You're looking at the question, what are you going to do with the additional $5 million? The following year, having spent the $55 million, you're doing the same thing. You're really not evaluating the programs in relation to what you feel they should be accomplishing. That's what we're talking about here. We're not talking about adhering to a strict regimen of a particular metrics, a particular set of metrics. We're just asking or suggesting that you, in approaching the budget, that you approach it that way rather than, and I know this oversimplifies the point, rather than how much did you get last year and what's a reasonable increment for you to get in the coming year.
But do you disagree with me that there's a risk of this type of system, if it's not very carefully designed, leading us towards a process that puts greater value on things that are easier to measure?
I really don't think that risk is there, because there are 120 of you sitting in this building who have the ability to vote on these things, who are going to raise questions like you're presently raising. And I'd say that's exactly what you're here to do. You're not here just to accept the premise that everything that's been done is what should continue to be done. To go back to the foster care example, no, we're not going to, unless 120 people in this building decide the state's not going to be involved in foster care. And if you do that, it's likely you're going to say that ought to be a local function, and the question would be, how are we going to finance it? What you are going to ask yourselves is, what are the objectives of that program, and are they being met? And how do we go about evaluating them? That's the point. I don't think there's a risk of getting too stuck on numbers, because there are enough of you with different points of view and with different experience to be able to get back into these issues and raise the question, this is a valuable program, even though I can't quantify what you're asking me to quantify.
And sorry, I can't face you at the same time. I'll let you in. When we're talking about performance measures, we're not talking about activity-based costing where we're looking at every pencil. We're looking at indicators. So, for instance, in the one example you gave about an endangered species coupled with some other measures of health of the environment and air quality, water quality, endangered species are indeed a fantastic indicator measure of certain qualitative, discrete issues within that piece of the environment. So indeed you can. The performance measures you would see in a performance budget are a very high level. It would show you how an individual program is doing it, whether it's within Cal EPA with toxics, whether it's with state parks, with how are they doing with their resource protection program. It would be those vital few measures, indicators on how well the program's performing, meeting its outcomes. I mean, that's the key. What's the outcome of what we're trying to do, and then what few measures would lead us to that outcome? So it's not the tedious level of performance measures that we're talking about.
My other question really is almost at the opposite end of the spectrum. And that is, during my time involved in the budget process, one of my great frustrations is our inability to measure and make decisions based on avoided costs in the future. Make decisions, we score for this year, and in a budget crisis, of course, is when it's the worst because you make a reduction and you don't contemplate what the downstream consequences are going to be. For example, you reduce the supports for somebody to live in their own home, the likelihood that they're going to be in a much more expensive setting in a nursing home increases. You know, you cut drug and alcohol treatment, the chances are there's going to be more people in prison. Now, one of the reasons that's difficult to measure is because it's cross-department, cross-agency, and it also requires you to think longer than the current year. But in your experience or observation with regards to performance-based budgeting that's been implemented elsewhere, are there methodologies included that attempt to look at how a expenditure and how it's carried out by the department affects the future spending in either in that part of state government or in other parts of state government?
Yes, California, this is kind of off track, but the states that do it the best have a statewide strategic plan that lists the members' priorities and the administrative priorities. Those become the priorities that departments follow and the budgets are concerned with, and performance budgeting works best in that environment. Well, we're not in that environment. So to answer your question, in the current environment, performance budgeting can predict from the targets pretty much any level of funding a department is given. And then that's up to the department to do. So for instance, if you say Department X is going to be cut 10%, they should be able to come back with you with actual metrics in a fairly short period of time on the actual impact of that on the individual programs. So if there's a disagreement on what you feel should be cut versus what the department is recommending, that should be the level of dialogue. And when I say you, yes, the members of this body, but also obviously with your staff behind the scenes to work on it.
Let me dive in here for 1 second. The structure of this requires that department heads submit to the governor a lot of information, including the objectives of the department and how the department is measuring up to those objectives and proposals as to how to measure success. We as a legislature under the proposal have the right to change the metrics if we wish to. Here's my thought about this. Let's take the example, because I share the precise frustration on the precise example that Mr. Esbro raised. So if you're in charge of DHS, a department that administers a program that goes to the heart of what you're talking about, I would argue that this enhances our capacity to weigh in early enough in the process to say, you know, as you're formulating your budget, let us give you a hint about a metric the legislature considers really important, and that is how your department is keeping people living independently rather than in nursing homes and how your programs are advancing that goal. That is a key metric, it seems to me, and it is a measurable one as well. And a quantifiable savings can emerge from that. This puts pressure on department heads to engage in that justification at an early stage as the budget is being formulated, pressure that currently is applied on a very ad hoc basis at best. So because I think it's a very legitimate concern, this is not a panacea for any of the problems we're discussing, but it enhances the tools of management and requires that those tools be applied year in and year out.
Mr. Chairman, if I could second that point from ARP's perspective, we're looking at all kinds of older California Act programs and programs that keep people secure in their homes that are at risk. And without the sort of bigger picture, what happens when people get sicker because they don't have those programs, what happens when they're forced into nursing homes, which are, as we all know, much more expensive than programs that keep people in the community. So I just wanted to fortify that point from ARP's perspective.
Great. Thank you. And by the way, with this discussion, because it's a little different than a regular bill, we're really discussing a broad topic, some members have sort of looked at me. If someone has a particular follow-up or a short point that they want to make, I really want this to be a discussion. So just indicate that to me that it's a follow-up, and I will take you out of order for a very brief comment or a brief question related to what's going on. And I want to encourage that because I want this to be really a conversation more than a traditional hearing. We do have an order, and as people contact, we'll get through to everybody. But let's be a little bit more liberal in terms of the way we do that. And so I'm going to move on now to Ms. Buchanan. Unless, Ms. Chesbrough, you were ready. Ms. Buchanan followed by Mr. Bell. But again, indicate to me if it's a follow-up that you have, and I'll call on you. Out of order. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and I appreciate all the work that all of you are doing. My caucus knows that I'm a very strong advocate of performance-based budgeting. I co-authored a bill last year with Assemblymember Nilo, and I'm co-authoring another bill which actually mirrors what you have, so I'm sure this will supersede it. But and I'm also a very strong proponent of total quality management. And if you think about Deming and how he transformed business in terms of having us focus more on quality in the system, he said that 15% of your problems are with the employees, 85% of your problems are with the system. So if you want to improve quality and you want to operate more effectively, focus on the system. And what we tend to do in California, whether it's education and wanting to blame teachers and administrators, or it's state government wanting to blame employees or bargaining units or whatever, is we focus on the 15%. And if we continue to focus on the 15%, we're never going to have the kind of improvements we need to make the changes we need to do to move California forward. One of the things that happens, excuse me, with workload budgeting is that it rewards the status quo. It rewards inefficiencies. Business hasn't done it for close to half a century. I was elected to school board in 1990. In 1991, we had to cut our budget by over 10%. We brought in zero-based budgeting, which isn't performance, but is a, they're all sort of a, you know, one is a variation of another. And we had tremendous results from that. It was extremely successful and allowed us to focus more dollars on the classroom. You know, with a workload budgeting system, if you have someone who's very bright and innovative and progressive, and they find ways to provide better service to the clients, to make improve morale, make their agency or division run more effectively, and they save 20%, we penalize them. We tell you you only spent 80% of your dollars, so we're going to give you less money next year. But if you have an agency that just doesn't want to change, or it's not efficient, or you know takes more money, we reward them because we base next year's budget on what you spent this year, and we just continue to reward that kind of practice. So I think if you take a look at the state of California, we all have to recognize that the demands on our state budget far exceed our ability to fund them, not only today in this given in the current economic crisis and recession, but far into the future. And I believe the only hope we have of trying to meet those needs is to find ways to be more productive, to find ways to be more efficient, to find ways to provide better service. And we have to make informed decisions. That means that the legislature needs good information to make decisions. And I think with performance-based budgeting, the part that's equally critical is not just the information you're giving us, but the performance-based management part and the information that is being requested and given to department agencies. Because performance-based budgeting, if all it is the legislature, is never going to work. It works because we're asking agencies to look at what they do differently and to manage differently. So I just have a couple more short comments. Because one, you know, I don't think this means that we abandon our social responsibilities or we abandon our commitment to schools. But I think what it means is if we do it right, we will have more money or a more stable source of funding for both those areas. I also believe that the cost or the price of doing nothing is just far too high a price that we're going to pay. Because when you look at California's economic cycles, we know that every about 3.5 years we have a recession. Most of those recessions are V-shaped recessions. Occasionally you have a situation like you do today or early 90s or back in the 1980s. And the only way we're going to get away from where we are today is to have a new system. Because the cycle we're on right now is that we have a shock to our economy and we make cuts. And we all kid ourselves if we just restore those cuts a few years later. When I was on school board in 1991, we cut reading specialists. That's almost 2 decades ago. We still haven't added them.
So we need to change how we do business, and I believe this is a great start in not only helping our agencies work more efficiently and making the legislature more transparent, but in restoring people's faith in the government of California. So thank you very much for all the work you've done.
Okay, before we move on to the next speaker, I want to go back to the beginning of the hearing where we had some housekeeping to do. The members have arrived, so I'm going to ask the secretary to please call the absent members with regard to the initial, which is a technical vote on AB 1610. The motion was do pass as amended. This is I'm asking for an aye vote from the Democratic members. It is a technical vote on the budget vehicles that we have to move forward. Secretary, please call the absent members.
Adams. Brownlee. Aye. Brownlee, aye. Caballero. Aye. Caballero, aye. Evans. Huffman. Aye. Huffman, aye. Jones.
We have 14 ayes, 10 not voting, 3 absent. That bill is passed. And if there's no objection, I'd like to substitute the roll from AB 1610 to include AB 1611 through and including AB 1637. Without objection, it is so ordered, and we move back to the hearing. Thank you. Next member with questions, comment was Mr. Bell, followed by Ms. Harkey.
Mr. Chair, if I might,
yes.
Representative Caltax is here, has not been able to speak, and she would like to briefly regarding performance-based budgeting. Is that correct? Yes, so I wanted just to offer that opportunity, if it's okay with the chair.
That would be fine, and keep in mind we're breaking it into 3 sections, and this section is
just
currently
performance-based budgeting.
Yes.
Please go ahead.
That's exactly why I'm here. I have some other comments for the other parts of the hearing, but I want to state my support for performance-based budgeting. I concur with all of the positive remarks that have been made about performance-based budgeting to this point. I think it makes a lot of sense. It's really about setting goals and figuring out what is the best way to achieve those goals. And are we achieving them, and how are we achieving them? So I think it makes a lot of sense, and I just wanted to let you know that.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Great. And since we've done that, I'll also ask Mark Hill from Finance to add your comments. I was going to do these extra comments at the end, but we'll add them in right now as part of the discussion. So go ahead, Mr. Hill.
Yeah. Well, I'd like to just make a couple of comments about performance budgeting and kind of the history that we've had here in California. We actually have tried it a number of times. We've tried it in a number of forms, and I think one of the things it would be useful as part of this effort to do is to be more clear than we have been in the past as to what it is that we're really trying to accomplish with this mechanism and get a more clear pathway forward than we've had in the past. The first time we tried performance budgeting, it was basically an informational exercise. We actually published both input, output, and in a few cases, outcome measures in the governor's budget. There was not a formal review process for that. It was used sporadically within the administration. Over time, we looked at how those performance outcomes and outputs were improving or not improving, and if we saw a problem, it was possible to intervene, but it wasn't something that was plugged into the regular budget process. That was discontinued as part of a budget cut. The next time that we tried it, we was basically the pilot that's been discussed. There was actually a couple of different versions of that. There were some zero-based budgeting pilots as well. That really kind of takes two forms as well. In many other states that do it now, basically what they're doing is they're doing some longitudinal analysis of performance. They're publishing performance statistics. They're reviewing them often offline from the budget. There's not necessarily a direct connection between the budget process and the program review process. There's a separate program review process. In many instances, the performance measures that are created and adopted are pretty much oriented towards the inside management of departments. And I think what you've heard from the witnesses before now is that tends to work pretty well. If you have a consistent, extended effort to have performance measures that help managers manage within the departments, that can have
pretty substantial, tremendous effects over time on what that department does and how well it does it. But that doesn't necessarily translate into anything that's going to affect the budget all that much. The performance pilot that we tried in the 90s, we actually tried to tie budget decisions to the performance measures. And that is very difficult because you have to do two things there. One, you have to come up with a relevant performance measure that the legislature and the chief executives of the state all agree is relevant to the budget, and you have to figure out how what that department does in various programs actually relates to that performance. That is involves usually a pretty substantial amount of research on what that department does. It requires some studies. It may require, again, some longitudinal analysis of historical data to see if there really is any correlation between the outcome measurement and what that department is doing. That part of it was very difficult to do. I don't say that it's impossible, but I don't think it's uniformly possible to do. It did not generally tend to result, when we did it in that pilot, with a lot of changes to the budgets of those departments. It tended to have more effect on how they were internally managed rather than externally overseen by the legislature and the governor. So I think what we would suggest at this point, that as part of the California Forward package, which the governor agrees is very worthy of consideration, is that if we're going to actually try to make performance measurement and performance management part of the budget process, the part of that that didn't work last time is it didn't get top-level buy-in by the legislature and the governor about what are the goals of that department, how will they be measured, and how does the budget of that department actually relate to those measurements. The other way of thinking about this is to say this is really more of a legislative and gubernatorial oversight mechanism. It's not necessarily something that plugs into the annual budget all that much. It's really designed to see when programs are maybe diminishing in performance, there's a problem, then you go in and you do an audit or you do a study and you try to figure out what's wrong with it, or you bring the department director up before the committees of the legislature and you ask them what's going on, why is this getting worse. There's a variety of different intervention mechanisms you can do. Or if you look at a program and you say, it's our judgment that this performance just isn't adequate for the dollars that we're spending here, then again, you can look at what can we do to make this better? And you take a focused effort on that particular program then to see what changes can be made in the structure of how that's delivered, what changes may be necessary in the management of that program. And it again may require some budgetary investments in new information technology systems, changes in the process, something else about that program, but it doesn't necessarily just require more effort on the same program. Most likely it requires change. So we see the performance measurement and management as both an internal within the executive branch management approach that can have pretty substantial benefits in many instances, but also on the external side when it comes to public review and the legislature's review. It's a way to identify programs that need more substantial oversight and may need some sort of serious intervention. The ultimate intervention could be you discontinue the program because you just can't figure out how to fix it. It's broken. But in most instances, you're going to be able to find some way of changing that program that makes it work better.
Here, go ahead.
Very, very briefly, Mr. Chair, I just want to point out that this package contains the following requirements. That as part of the budget process, every agency has to submit, along with its detailed, complete budget, its mission and goals, how it intends to achieve those goals, performance measures and targets determining progress toward those goals, how the agency performed in the previous year in achieving those goals, with explanations for deviations from targeted sets of performance goals, and legislation it proposes to enhance the efficiency and performance of the agency. So this would become not an ad hoc process as it might be now, but a systemic requirement that, again, coupled with the legislature's capacity as directed to amend the performance metrics as we see fit, and the direction that we oversee each department in a 10-year cycle, creates the system that I think the administration is suggesting we need to have.
Okay. Mr. Nielsen, on that point.
Let me ask from a historical perspective, though. We sometimes reinvent the wheel. You mentioned some good points of the prior application here of performance-based, zero-based, and how that kind of worked out. During the Wilson administration, there was this massive, and there's probably been an update on it, effort to define strategic plans in all of the agencies. Now, you were talking about those missions and goals and purposes. Aren't those already extant because of the development or evolution of the strategic plans? Are those strategic plans doing anything more than gathering dust?
The strategic planning effort from that era was fairly short-lived. I think some departments still do it on their own because they find it valuable. Some of the departments that have been involved in the performance-based budgeting pilots may be still doing them. They're no longer required. I think we found at finance that they weren't highly valuable because, again, they were the real problem with them that was that they were departmental level products. They were proposals about what my mission should be, what my goals should be, and there wasn't a process either within the administration or within the legislature to ever agree with them, and there was not agreement with them. And so they became, this is what I want to do from the department director's point of view, but not necessarily what the administration wanted to do, and certainly there was never any process to get buy-in from the legislature. I mean, I would even suggest that if the legislature really wants to endorse program goals, program missions, and program performance measures, you might consider even adopting them in statute so that it's clear this is the long-run approach that we're going to take to looking at this program. And there's not a question of this is going to change every year. We're going to, you know, have a different idea every year about what we're looking for. But if you have it in a bill, if you have it in something that has, it gets printed and people can go back to, it's going to have more impact.
That would complete my observation because one of my concerns is performance measure is in the eyes of the beholder or the eyes of the special interest. So how do we lock that in? You're offering sort of a static requirement in statute. I'd be more comforted in that because I can see how we special interests or individuals would be defining the performance measures and they would be continually dynamic to not to allow a measure of performance but a justification of what you're doing again.
Ms. Harkey, quickly on that point, and then Mr. Bell, and then back to Ms. Harkey for her question.
I just have a question on what you said, and my question goes to probably, it's hopefully simply answered, but can the current legislature commit future legislatures? I was told we could not do so. So in establishing that, you know.
Yeah, well, I'll answer the question. This proposal includes a constitutional amendment that binds future legislatures and a statute that binds future legislatures. It is possible that the statute, which implements the directive of a constitutional change, could be amended over time. But there's a constitutional directive at stake here.
I understand that. Okay.
Yeah, you're after. Mr. Bell is next, followed by Ms. Harkey, followed by Mr. Puritani.
I think... first of all, I want to say something about who a lot of us are. Most of us have no preconceived, preconceived ideas about the state budget or we're not committed to the state budget. In other words, we didn't develop the state budget. Most of us haven't served more than 2 or 3 years here in Sacramento. And we're not committed to the past. That's the first thing. So, given that most of us come from someplace, Mike Feer and I come from local government. A lot of the other colleagues come from local government, other positions. So our preconceived ideas about budgets tend to come from where we came from. Joan Buchanan, school board. So we have different ways of doing things. My preconceived bias comes from having served as 12 years on the San Jose Council and 14 years as a county supervisor, and 22 years on the Metropolitan Transportation Commission. So I come from local and regional government. Our process, and we do a lot of performance budgeting, a lot more than they do at the state. In fact, it's amazing how little. That was one of the shocks I had when I came here. One of the shocks I had was how little people even look months ahead in terms of the budget, as little as possible. It was amazing how the budget process here doesn't look ahead to see where they're spending the money or where the ship's going. So I'm a believer in developing long-range, I guess you can call it strategic plans. If we have a major strategic plan, every single department should be at that meeting and should buy in and sign up and be told they are to implement that plan. I don't care if they're not the direct department, but every single department has to buy in and say, you will make this strategic plan adopted by the legislative body and signed by the governor. You will participate in making this a reality. So we should have a system that does that, first of all, before we go into performance management on the budget. So we should say, here's our plan. Here's what everybody agreed to. In 5 years, we want to have half the kids in California be victims of child abuse. Lower the prison population. Have the education system perform at this level. That should be our strategic vision that we all agree on. And that's the way we do it at local government. The second thing I'll say is there's a lot of barriers, and I think our budget process is a barrier. And I know some of my members are going to agree with me on this, because I think the appropriations process in the assembly, after being here for 3 years, I think it is a major barrier to doing any kind of change in setting up long-range goals or long-range objectives. We need to deal with the appropriations process. So if the appropriation process doesn't conform to the strategic vision and the budgeting, then if it's off on its own, doing its own thing, setting up different standards, looking at only a short-term, period of time, what we're doing here is not going to make any difference. Okay? I think that also another one, I think we have to have strategic plans for departments that have direct services run by the state, and we have to have a different approach, perhaps by other state budget allocations that are mainly the responsibility of local government. And I think sometimes the state is overly prescriptive to local government. And I think if you're going to have strategic goals, it should be done in conjunction with the local governments. The local governments in California, many of them are larger than state governments elsewhere. There are a lot of local governments that of the budget size and the population. And I'm not just talking about Los Angeles. There are many local governments that are bigger than some state governments in terms of their budget, the number of staff, the population they serve. So I think we have to look at our local governments as allies in our strategic vision and our performance. I think that we have defunded local government over the years and been overly prescriptive. And why do I know that? Because every time when I was a local government official and I went to New York to sell bonds for the city of San Jose or the county of Santa Clara, every single time I talked to Moody's, Standard & Poor's, they said, well, your bonds are not going to be rated as highly. And I said, well, why not? We have a good, efficient local government. They say, well, because in California, the California government is more prescriptive towards local government than any other place in the United States. In other words, there's more laws that restrict local government than any other place in the United States. So we're going to make you pay higher interest on your bonds. And that's true, and I think we ought to recognize it. And so being overly prescriptive is not the right formula to make our money be used wisely. And the last point I want to make is silos of programs. This place has so many silos. We had a Stanford study. We talked about school funding. There's too many silos. I know in social services, we have the Department of Corrections going one way. We have the social service going another way. There's no unity in terms of purpose. We need to have joint agreement between and crossover actions between the departments. And if we're going to have performance budgeting for a department, we ought to make sure that performance requirement is matched in all the other departments for the strategy. So if you have like a social service agency doing one part of the child abuse program and the criminal justice programs doing another part, you ought to make sure that they have matched up their performance goals and objectives. So we have the strategy complete. And I think that's going to be a very difficult thing to do. But right now for me, the place is a mess. We got to change this. This is a mess. I came here, and I've never seen such convoluted, odd, crazy, unscientific budget process in my, now it's 30 years, actually, 30 years. I've been in elected full-time office. I've never seen anything like the state of California. So we're at the bottom of the barrel. We have to start crawling to the top of the barrel and be the best state, not the worst state.
Thank you, and hopefully that's where we're starting on that process today and as part of this California Forward. And a number of the issues, you made some very good points, and some of the stuff in terms of performance management I know we're going to be dealing with in the second panel. A lot of the issues, I think, second and third panel will go much quicker, I think, because we're bringing up a lot of the issues that are you really can't separate. But we'll continue along this path with Ms. Harkey, followed by Mr. Furutani, followed by Mr. Ruskin.
First, I'd like to thank you for your work as well, and I'd like to echo the comments made by my colleague, Ms. Buchanan. I think we do need to go this way, and Mr. Beal, I congratulate him also on the overprescriptive to the local governments. We are like a nation state. Our counties are many states, as has been stated, and I think we really have to stop the top-down approach, because what works in San Francisco or works up in the northern end of California does not necessarily work at the border in the south, nor in Orange County, nor in LA in between. And so I would love to see us get away from that, because we are just so different. There's just unbelievable. When you're up here and trying to govern, you see it just plainly. It's just not the same world. A lot of this is constitutional, but is there a penalty for not complying with the Constitution? Is there anything included?
No. First, let me be really clear about which is in which place. The statutory framework delineates the performance-based budgeting component. The constitutional element compels that we establish an oversight process and performance standards to evaluate each program. In either instance, a failure to comply with the directives is a violation of law. Well, presumably a taxpayer can sue, saying you're not following the law.
Okay, well, that's my question.
Remedy is if it were, Mr. Nathaniels, what the remedy is, presumably if we were deviating from the requirements of statute or the Constitution, the remedy is an order that compels us to comply with the rules.
I just rather than make this an open conversation, that's one of the problems that we're having right now, quite honestly, is that in our budgeting process and in our taxation, which is the revenue neutral process, we are violating Constitution, but because it's not challenged, it's allowed to continue. So we're still going to be relying on somebody to challenge if we're not doing our job. So that's I think a shortcoming that maybe we can correct with some modification. I think that Mr. Chesbrough hit kind of the nail on the head when he said that there were a lot less tangible things and how could they be measured. One of the items that's been a real problem, or one of the real problems with our present system, is that there has been no willingness to reduce anything. because there is this, you know, I mean, it's, I think there's multitude of pressure groups. We have some huge pressure groups. Like, for, I guess my question is, one of my questions is education subject to performance-based budgeting as well?
Now, everything is subject to
performance. So how would that work with the Prop 98?
Well, the Prop 98 guarantee remains the Prop 98 guarantee. But you could imagine a series of performance measures that assess the quality with which that money is being spent and the objectives that are being furthered and so on. And I do want to say, since I've been in this body, we have cut tens of billions of dollars from programs. So it is not the case that we have not been able to do that. What is the case is that frequently the mechanism by which we make those cuts has not been as well informed as it could be. And the thing about performance-based budgeting is it gives us a much more objective basis on which to assess whether a program should continue, and if so, in what form.
Okay, well, I disagree that we've made tens of billions of cuts, because I have not seen them, and I've seen some one-time maneuvering, but it's all coming back next year, which is a very much a concern of mine. Next year, after this election, we're going to be faced with just an extremely upside-down situation, which brings me to my next point, is what is the cost of implementation? When we are looking at $20 billion deficits for probably the next 5 years, what is going to be the cost of implementation here?
Yeah, the costs of implementing these approaches have not yet been quantified, in part because they're contingent on future decisions. For example, this compels the package compels the legislature within a year to create a system by which we evaluate every program in state government. The method by which that happens is, among other things, pursuant to a team approach comprised of both the executive and the legislative branches. We can't say yet what will emerge from that directive, so it's not yet quantified. But there will be some costs of implementing this. One of our prior members of the panel of the committee said something I think that's right, and that is there will be costs associated with this meaningful change in the manner in which we do business. But those costs are a good investment, a great investment, in assuring that our dollars in the future are spent in their highest and best way.
Yeah, I agree with you. And you're from Department of Finance?
Right, Department of Finance.
Okay. I'm sorry, I lost my train of thought. I'll come back to you.
Okay,
Thank you.
On the point you were making, though, I'd like to ask a follow-on, which is, in other states, have they had to add positions, or has there been additional cost in implementing? To follow on to your question, how has that worked in particular? You mentioned there were several states that had done it very effectively. I'd be curious which states and if it did add to the cost.
I believe, you know, off the top of my head, I can't mention all the states, but it is in another document that was produced by this body when they did the informational hearing on at the accountability committee that Member Buchanan and Caballero are on. So that kind of enumerates some of the states. But let me give some generic remarks. In the states that implemented it, they ultimately wound up with dollar savings. So the upfront costs, when I was at the performance review we looked at, were pretty minor compared to the savings that were realized almost immediately from using quality management tools for better internal efficiency. With state parks, we received absolutely no appropriation in addition to what we were already receiving to implement performance budgeting. We were given, in trailer bill language, flexibility from some of the state's more dumb mandates. That's a technical term we kind of use in performance budgeting. So, for instance, we didn't have to go through the futile exercise of every 6 months rotating positions so that you didn't lose a position. And every department does that. It seems like a good idea, but where the vacancy is not where the vacancy winds up, because no department's going to lose them. So we didn't have to do that. Well, that expenditure freed up 2 to 3 personnel years of time that we could focus on developing performance measures and budgets so that if we needed to lose positions, you could make that decision based on how we were performing. Something else I think that's important, The Government Performance and Results Act was passed in 1993 by Congress. All state agencies currently that receive federal funds have to report on how, on their performance on the use of those funds. The federal government basically is getting better performance information on how departments operate than you are, because that information doesn't come to this body. So part of the mechanism is already in place, so the cost issue is not that great. One thing from finance that I do want to comment on. We successfully worked with the Department of Finance's CalSTARS unit to capture the cost of the program outcomes at the field level. In other words, the CalSTARS system was able to handle performance budgeting. Now, the mechanisms that exist today would make it far easier to do that. But consider where we were in 1994 to 99. CalSTARS was able to be modified to capture that, and our accounting system worked on.
Mr. Furutani, followed by Mr. Ruskin, followed by Mr. Berryhill.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. And I wanted to thank the panel for a brief aha moment. As we talk about performance-based budgeting, I think you put it well. I'm sorry, I don't remember your name, but it isn't a matter of just performance-based budgeting. It deals with strategic planning and all of these things put together. Because if we don't know what we want to accomplish, you can hold people accountable and measure all day long, but for what end? And I think the end is what the gentleman from AARP talked about, to in a general sense of having people have confidence in government again. And so as we deal with this issue, and the three of us right here are three of the chairs of the sub-budget committees, and just in talking to each other, I just got appointed myself, just sharing some real brief notes, we all look at each other and go, it's happening in your committee too? Yeah, my committee too. I'll give you a small example, and these are good folks. I know they're all good folks, but it's a question of reality. On one hand, we're cutting and laying people off and doing these draconian cuts. On the other hand, we're hiring people because we have special funds. So when the public looks at it, they're going, what is reality here? What's the real world? We have to look at that committee and those departments based upon what our strategic goal is, then measure how we get to those goals, and then we can hold people accountable. Right now, I think what's talked about in government is the word accountability. Everybody, education particularly, accountability, test, test, test. For what end? Just to do it, just to do it? As it turns out, more often than not, it's for punishment more than anything else. So I think the key thing, and the gentleman from the Department of Finance said it, that if it comes from the governor and the legislature, it's a mandate as a strategic goal, objective, whatever we want, term we want to use, outcomes. If it comes from the level of leadership, then everybody's got to get in line and follow it, and then we evaluate. The problem is that because of term limits, a lot of people in the bureaucracy, it's natural. You can just sort of wait to see who the chair is going to be or when the election cycle is and, you know, who's this or who's that. And so what we need to do in this, and this is a great start, Mike, I really appreciate this effort, and I appreciate the effort of California Forward, is to look at this in terms of the difference. But I think on one hand, we have to be careful of not being too prescriptive without giving the overall strategic view so people know how what they do fits into accomplishing those strategic goals. So if one of the goals is to get people to have confidence in government again, needs to say we have to break that down. What does that mean? Well, one way to do that is have more transparency. We know that. Another way to do that is to hold people accountable. And then if we do that, then there's got to be an end game to that. If they succeed, great. If they don't succeed, what happens? We were just comparing notes about IT. I mean, I'm an education guy, but now I'm dealing with prisons. But when they told me about prisons, I kept thinking, LA Unified, LA Unified, LA told me the very same thing, same issues. One big issue we have in every department we're dealing with is everybody's trying to get away from 3x5 cards and shoeboxes, right? Data, IT. But when we look at all the different IT projects we're doing in all of the different departments, they're all over the place. A few of them are working. Some have been struggling for almost a decade. But if we put them side by side by side and look at what is the strand that works, what isn't working, and we look at it across departments, across areas, I think that's where we start finding where the performance-based budgeting and accountability issues can come into play. I think this is it's going to be exciting. It's going to be tough because ultimately when we have that strategic discussion at the level of leadership, we're all going to say we want good government. And then our friends on one side of the aisle are going to say, well, good government to me is, and on the other side of the aisle, we can say, well, good government to me is, and it might go like this. So then we have to find where that common ground is. I mean, it's interesting, right? Budget is the elephant in the living room. Budget, we talk about dollars and cents, revenue, expenditures. But really, at the end of the day, that 7 a.m. morning decision that gets made after we stay up for two nights in a row, it's more ideological than it is dollars and cents, because it's a reflection of how people view what government is.
Thank you. Mr. Ruskin, followed by Mr. Berryhill.
Well, essentially, as a legislature, we have the role of setting policy. We have the role of management only insofar as we can be certain that the policies that we're setting and are being carried out effectively. And we have the role of budgeting to match the policies that we prioritize. But so we have to, I think, understand that to a very significant extent, our policy setting responsibilities and authorities do give us certain management responsibilities, in the sense that we must decide what our policies are, and there's no way in which we can assume that we can set policies and do a good job without creating some pathway to understand whether those policies are being carried out. I think no organization can proceed without some performance-based objectives. So to the degree that it's very obvious that we really don't proceed with performance-based objectives in mind. It's sometimes vaguely done. We talk about the value of certain policies every year, but we don't decide whether the policies are being carried out correctly. This is an obvious deficiency. I think no organization can proceed this way. Going back to what Mr. Bell said, local government. I served in local government for 9 years. I think it's fair to say that the local government I served on had an excellent reputation for getting things done. And we developed a performance-based strategy. It wasn't zero-based budgeting. There are other things, but it was performance-based. We decided every 2 years, and then tweaked it every year, what the priorities were of the city and which of those priorities were most urgent and which could we afford. So we created priorities, and then we created the goals, the outcomes that we expected to have to occur as a result of setting those priorities. The performance of the city manager was based almost solely upon his or her ability to carry out those priorities. So I think what this gets us to is that I think the idea that we can perform our task well as policymakers without also better understanding what outcomes we expect from the policies, I believe, is just fallacious. No organization can proceed in that way. But we do also have to prioritize And in an organization this large, the state of California, I think we will have to, if this is adopted, we will have to become adept at how we do that to avoid micromanagement or to avoid setting up benchmarks that we can't even follow. So we'll have to delegate performance reviews not only to agencies but to regional and local governments, and perhaps only review at the very top level. Let me comment upon Mr. Chesbrough's remarks. I share Mr. Chesbrough's concerns about important programs that are less easily quantifiable. But on the other hand, I still think we need to have performance measurements and outcome measurements because, one, those programs that are easily amenable to quantification need to be, so we still need to do that. And even those programs that are not as easily quantifiable are still very important programs, which is what Mr. Chesbrough was asserting, and I agree with that. So they have to be measured in some way. And I believe that if, you know, looking at the business that I was in, looking at local government, I believe that while some measurements, some programs are not as easily measurable quantifiably, there are still ways in which the outcomes can be measured. That has to be the case. Otherwise, we couldn't have instituted the policy. We had to have some sense of what it was we were instituting the policy to accomplish. And therefore, there has to be some way of measuring the outcome successfully. As an example, healthcare may in some ways be less quantifiable than others. But as an example, the San Mateo County redid the entire way in which it did healthcare by concentrating on the outcomes in terms of the people receiving the healthcare, rather than just quantifiable measurements. They began to measure their ultimate quality of life. And it's generally been regarded as a very successful outcome. So I very much wholeheartedly support this effort. It will have to be done smartly to ensure that it is adopted wisely and to ensure that it's adopted in more than name only. But I think it's very important, and I don't know any other way in which an organization can proceed.
Thank you, Mr. Perryhill.
Yeah, well, without reiterating what my colleagues have said, short of maybe reiterating a little, Jim Bell is so right. We just, the striking thing coming up here is the little oversight that is done, and so I'm excited about the idea of going to performance. This is very exciting. We on our school board, I served 11 years, and really when we turned our school district around, it was because of a good strategic plan. It created focus for the district and the priorities and all those great things that you need. But what I would like to ask is, with the oversight that comes with a good strategic planning process like that, would not a two-year budget make sense? And if not, why? And if so, maybe that's what we should be looking at as well.
Well, I'll start. There is a form of two-year budget that we'll be talking about in a few minutes, because this proposal also contemplates the requirement that the governor at budget time submit a budget for the upcoming fiscal year and a budget for the next fiscal year, so we understand fully the implications of our decisions in year one, in addition to revenues and expenditures for 3 years beyond. So you get a five-year snapshot every year,
right,
on an ongoing basis. That is part of what we talk about in this proposal, and which is why, again, these proposals are designed to be interlocking proposals. The purest form of two-year budgeting, in which one budgets for 2 years at the outset, does basically no legislation in year one and then does legislation in year two, has met with objections from both sides of the aisle during the course of our reform committee discussions. People, generally speaking, wanted to see longer-term thinking infused into the process, But recognizing how the numbers change with some frequency, we're less prepared to look at a pure two-year budget model. So what we have before us is a version of what you're talking about, right, designed to complement the performance-based piece we're done now.
Yeah, yeah, the idea thinking that you could do, if you did a two-year budget in a pure sense, then you would have that same year you were doing budgeting, you could do your oversight and you could be taking a look at all your benchmarks and objectives and goals that year, and then the following year focus on legislation, but and then maybe some budget review. But I get what you're saying.
And for what it's worth, this proposal, the next thing we'll talk about is the oversight that you just alluded to, contemplates walking and chewing gum at the same time, doing the budget, oversight of every single program, and doing legislation concurrently.
Ms. Brownlee, followed by Mr. Jeffries.
Oh, just one quick thing. And by the way, because those burdens are extensive, the discussion that we're not having today includes the decision that we're going to reduce our bills by at least a third starting next year, so we can focus more time specifically on the oversight that you're advocating. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just wanted to, thank you, and thank you, Mr. Fuhr, for bringing this forward and all the work that you've done on this, and I certainly am in concurrence with the direction of which it's going. I wanted to kind of further the questioning around the educational piece for just a minute, and understanding that, you know, of the California state budget, 40% of it or so are dollars spent for education. And most of those dollars are in the form of revenue limit, which goes, directly to the school districts, of which there are certainly governing boards. So, but the concept of performance-based, while I can see how it works in the structure that we're talking about, I see very well how it works with the Department of Education, very small piece of the overall educational budget dollars. Our lines of authority within the educational arena between the State Board of Education, the Department of Education, the Superintendent of Public Instruction, School Board Authority, you know, the lines are sometimes not relatively clear. So I think the way in which the state interacts with school districts and school boards relative to the way they account for monies being spent is a structure in which does not support performance-based or even program-based budgeting in any way, shape, or form. I mean, the school accounting system is set up to just do bean counting, and that's about it. And so I think, I certainly have been advocating since I've been in the legislature the notion of real school finance reform, not dealing with the formula of 98 necessarily, but dealing with all of the formulas by which money flows from Sacramento to school districts and school districts then to schools. And I believe strongly that if we were to reform that, we would yield a level of transparency by which we could get closer to this place of a legislature being able to sort of really oversee and see how money is being spent. And simultaneously, we're beginning to collect data on student performance and student outcomes, which is a really good thing, and to be able to kind of connect financial data and how school districts are doing relative to what the state objectives and to the degree of where they defining where they want to go. And so I think relative to this structure that we're discussing today, I think works really well for the traditional oversight of looking at departments. I think that we are going to need to have some further discussions relative to how we might have to adjust this process by which we would do it to really account for each dollar that we invest. Now, there are certain programs from the state, like class size reduction, which would be a good thing to be able to measure. We're giving monies to schools and to see what the outcomes are and what the performance is, and are schools really being able to reduce class size. You know, there are some specific things, but overall, the preponderance of money allocated from the state to school districts, again, is in the form of revenue limit, which, you know, goes through this process, which I think does not support performance-based budgeting.
Something that we all should, I mean, Mr. Silva, I think, has a comment, actually.
Now, on that, and you might want to connect the discussion you had on performance measurement and oversight. One of the rationales for the proposal here is to add an additional institutional obligation on the part of the legislature to do oversight. Your constitutional obligation on legislating is clear, but the oversight obligation has been one that's been left to multiple legislatures over time. So we're suggesting to institutionalize that. But specifically to Ms. Brownsley's point, we're suggesting that that oversight be not only for state programs, but for whether the program is managed by the state or a local agency. Because it's clear, as you point out, there's a great deal of state resources that are provided to local agencies, whether they're counties or schools, that you expect some kind of outcome. And that's why we integrated that local side with the performance and oversight in order for you to do that. And it may be that the first step you get into in oversight is to say that the school finance system needs to be upended in order to produce that. So just a footnote on the question about costs that was discussed earlier. Work we did that we provided for the committee staff about looking at different state models and lessons learned from states, we discovered that it wasn't so much a cost that people focused on, but rather was to change the existing culture. So for the most part, it wasn't as though states had to spend millions of dollars to transfer into some other system, but rather that the budgeting culture and the people who were managing old-style budgets changed to manage new-style budgets.
Mr. Jeffries.
If I may, a couple of observations. First, I want to thank you, and I want to thank all of you for your efforts on reform. I wish I could be a part of it, but we're not allowed to be a part of it. I say we as this Republican caucus, we don't get to engage in meaningful reform efforts. And much of this discussion today would have been better off just occurring in your caucus meeting amongst yourselves to determine how you're going to enhance one-party rule. Because at the end of the day, most of this is to achieve a faster, more efficient one-party rule. It is not to expand the dialogue and the bipartisanship, because if it was, we would have a meaningful say in the language that is being proposed. And I say this not to be mean-spirited, because I am sincerely appreciative of reform efforts and transparency efforts. Truly am. I mean, this institution is so broken for a number of reasons, not just partisan, just, you know, the nature of humans. When they have power, they don't want to give it up. I don't care what party you put in place. Once they get a taste of power, they're humans. They want to hang on to it. But we can do better than this. I mean, one party has, what, 45% of the vote, and the other has 30% of the vote. Some of what I see here just gives that one party 100% control. And I say this in part out of frustration, as someone who has reform bills proposed, who cannot even get a hearing, who the bills are not even allowed out of the Rules Committee, almost a year and a half now. And so when the author comes with sincere efforts, and you gentlemen come with sincere efforts for reform, great. But the reality is this building does not allow bipartisanship, at least not in any meaningful way. So I apologize for being somewhat cynical of efforts to make this a more efficient and faster process, because I know it's going to come at my expense. My community, my district, my 450,000 people, our voice is not going to be heard when you're done. Our voice is going to be left out, because it is going to be one-party rule. And so I would encourage you, as you move forward in this effort, and the author, please do everything you can to push beyond what leadership wants to allow, what the power brokers across the street want to allow, and allow our voices to be heard in this process, and let us have some meaningful input and see some results from that. Because that is how we're going to build bipartisan trust and a bipartisan working relationship in here.
Mr. Chair.
We introduce bills that have reform, and if they even get out of the Rules Committee, it's a miracle, And then the next step, if they get to a committee, they're killed instantly because leadership is not determined that they're acceptable to proceed. So we want to be a part of this. I want to be a part of this. This author is on the right path. At the end of the day, we're going to be irrelevant to the final decision because nobody's going to ask us, or if they are, it's not going to be language that we would like to see included in any meaningful way.
Mr. Chair, if I might respond.
Go ahead.
Mr. Jeffries is a good friend of mine with whom I enjoy a terrific working relationship, and I feel the need to be sure the record is clear. When the reform committees were formed, they were formed not only to be bicameral, but bipartisan. We held our first session here. It was asked by one of the Republicans from the Senate that there be an additional appointee from the Republican Party. That day, the Speaker committed to allowing that to happen. That was conveyed to the minority leader, and that appointment actually was never made, but the offer was extended multiple times. Those hearings were bipartisan hearings. I will tell you that throughout the course of those hearings, given today's agenda, there was unanimity among those who spoke, Republicans and Democrats alike, in support of performance-based budgeting, stronger oversight, and infusing more long-term thinking into the budget process. Those are the three topics before us today. As the chair of the Reform Committee here in the Assembly, I then personally went on at least two occasions to each Republican member of the committee privately to vet these ideas, to assure we were on the right track. Each hearing reflected, there was a document prepared that reflected the consensus that emerged from that hearing since there was no vote each time. This was about the most bipartisan process we have ever experienced in this building, both structurally and in terms of how this committee was run. Finally, the work product that's before us today is not a product of one party or another. In fact, conspicuously throughout this discussion, we've focused on the fact that this is a bipartisan proposal that is before us for consideration. And most significantly, to your point, Mr. Jeffries, it is not as though you have no voice, just the opposite. Even if you overlook every single conspicuous, hard-fought effort to assure fully bipartisan discussion throughout the course of this reform effort, it remains at the end of the day that there will have to be bipartisan support for this bipartisan package in order for the voters to have the opportunity to weigh in. So I do, with due respect to my friend Mr. Jeffries, take exceptionally strong issue to the notion that this was not a bipartisan process up to this moment, because I personally have guaranteed that it was. The speakers have guaranteed that it was. And the effort requires cross-party teamwork right now. Otherwise, the losers will not be Republicans or Democrats, be the people of the state who will see yet again an opportunity to meaningfully reform our government foregone because of reasons that they don't care about. I urge that we have bipartisan support for a comprehensive package. Today's elements I know reflect bipartisanship because I've talked with every person involved in this process from the Republican Party.
And I, if I may, I so hope you are right. And if I may ask, who is your Republican co-author?
On this measure, yeah. There's not a Republican co-author on the whole package, the comprehensive package.
And how is this a bipartisan proposal?
It emerged from the bipartisan, let me say two things. As you mentioned at the outset, there are two components to this package, the reform package. One component is not even before this committee because it's being put in place without any need for votes. Reduction in bills, for example, Mr. Berryhill was asking about it, reduction in bills and direct incentives to have bipartisanship by having bipartisan authored bills have extra limits, for example, much stronger oversight, an array of other changes that don't require this committee's effort. But then there's this part here, this particular measure. It's the result of the bipartisan effort of California Forward, which happens to mirror the discussion we had in the committee. Now, I would welcome Republican co-authors on this measure. It would be a great thing. But on California Forward's team, from which this package in these words emanated, are Republicans and Democrats. Mr. Houck, chair of the Business Roundtable, Republican, here in support of this measure. Mr. Hertzberg, a former speaker, not here today, a proponent of this measure. bipartisan through and through. Yesterday, in another one of our colleagues' districts, there was a forum on this package. One of the principal speakers in favor of it is a former Republican legislator from California Forward, who had a role in creating this package.
And we'll have to settle on splitting hairs, but if I walked into one of your committees and said, I have a bipartisan proposal, a bill, that has no Republican, in your case, has no Democrat support, it'd be awfully difficult for me to say with a straight face that this is a bipartisan bill.
Bills emerge with co-authors all the time as the bill goes through the process. I would welcome your participation in this. Thank you, Mr.
Just a little point I wanted to make.
Okay, and obviously it's a necessity that for this bill, for the constitutional portions of this bill, that we have two-thirds. So it's going to be, if anything, I would say that the minority party will have a disproportionate impact on the outcome of this. Just from a partisan perspective, I mean, if I were to have written this from a partisan perspective of the way I'd like to see it, it would look a lot different. There's a lot of pieces of this that are not my cup of tea. I'm looking at it trying to do what I said at the beginning, which is separate the perfect from, you know, make sure that it's not the enemy of the good, and that if there is something that can emerge, and I think California Forward has put something together that's worthy of our looking at in a bipartisan way. And I'm trying to make these hearings as bipartisan, as collaborative as possible, because ultimately, after we go through many hours already on this one piece, but many more hours as we go through all of the pieces, what will hopefully emerge is a package that every member of this committee can sign on to. That may be a pipe dream, but that would be the ideal, as if we work it through, we make minor tweaks to it, but we keep the package and the bipartisan spirit that it was brought to us in, and you know, swallow what we have to swallow that we can, but you know, put forward the parts that we like, and I'll give a little bit. Maybe we can emerge with that package.
Mr. Chair, it does seem to me that if the absence of Republican co-authors is the defect that's being that's causing an issue, that's easily curable. I myself was going to ask if I could be added as a co-author, and I wonder if Mr. Jeffries would join me. Let's take that off the table.
If Mr. Jeffries gets to insert some of his language, you bet.
I'm accepting the California Forward bipartisan language myself.
I appreciate you doing that. I don't.
Okay. Well,
because from my perspective, it just strengthens one-party rule.
Okay, but before we get to that, since we've gone through now one piece, issue one on performance-based budgeting, and on this particular piece, I didn't hear a lot of partisanship. What I heard and what I saw on this one piece was a lot of nodding of heads, a lot of questions. But generally, I'm misreading the room, but I read a lot of agreement. Now, I think that will change as we go through some of the other pieces, but at least everything we've covered so far seems to be fairly bipartisan. And with that, let's move to the next piece.
May I make one more comment on this one?
Yes, Mr. Chesbrough.
I'd like to echo the promise that our speaker made to try to move away from the Big Five process as essential to this kind of process being successful. I do not believe, from having sat through many years of budget subcommittee hearings, that unless we can return to a meaningful subcommittee and committee decision-making process, that we will have, no matter what criteria we give a department, and no matter what direction we try to give them, that they're going to take seriously those things and feel accountable. You know, I think Mr. Rami used the B&B word, you know, be here before yeah, and be here after yeah. I think until they believe that we have control over what budget's going to go to the governor, the people who are questioning them about their performance, that we will be able to achieve this. So that's sort of a structural component that is not part of this proposal, but it reinforces the importance of us engaging. And this relates a little bit to the comments Mr. Jeffries was making. We engage as a legislature the way we were intended to constitutionally and move the decision-making upstream. That's when we get departments coming in thinking we need to answer the legislature's questions and be accountable and have this process work. So just wanted to make that comment.
And the more accountable they are, the more engaged that the subcommittees and the budget process itself will be, I think the more bipartisan, I think this is the point you're making, that we'll feel, because we'll all be engaging in that process as it goes and not just sort of seeing what comes out of the black box at the end. With that, I'd like to move to issue number two and performance management. We've covered some of the ground already in this and in issue three, but we'll go through it and take testimony now on performance management.
You know, I'll just very quickly summarize where we are, because I think we have covered a lot of it. The constitutional provision requires that the legislature establish performance standards for all state departments and to evaluate all state departments using those standards. The cycle is at least once a decade, and that process commences a year from the effective date of this matter. Now, obviously, already this year, we have begun to establish a robust form of oversight in both houses. My committee, and I know others as well, are having at least hearings on at least five separate key topics as we assess what's happening currently. That's a beginning. This language takes us to a next step and doesn't depend on who's in office. It rather requires by Constitution that the legislature form committees, have a precise process. If you have questions about the details, we can go through those details. But the bottom line should be another bipartisan approach, which is we ought to know whether programs are working or not. Happy to take questions.
Okay. And any other panelists have specific testimony to this? And
then Fred Silva, let me make a couple of points about it. Mark Hill said it best that there is a connection between performance management and an oversight system. And as I mentioned earlier, we think it's important to institutionalize it so it's one of your underlying roles. The second is looking around at other states, having a joint committee having the responsibility for it is important, notwithstanding the fact that the houses may well be involved in it, and for that matter, a joint committee may assign it that way. But if you think about your joint audit committee or think about the JLBC, the Joint Legislative Budget Committee, you all over time have taken major activities that were institutional activities, not just house activities, but institutional activities, and assigned them to some joint body. And we felt that a general oversight function would be best supervised at the joint level. The second piece is that to get this thing up and running, we thought it would be important as within a year of the operative date of this proposal that a schedule be set up so that the Department of Finance and the executive branch knows the kinds of programs that are going to be reviewed. Obviously, you're going to continue to work on that schedule. It isn't that that's the only schedule, but at least to get it started, you'd need to set up a review schedule. Hopefully, that schedule would have the knowledge of those departments that had developed their performance measurements so that within a year of this operation, you'd start into this cycle. And that cycle would continue on as an institutional obligation as opposed to simply a view that a speaker or a minority leader decided in a particular year to undertake it.
Okay. I'll start with a question, which is, it's based on a 10-year cycle is what it's currently written at. And I sort of wondered given the term limits that we're under, we're only here for 6 years. So would it make more sense to lower the number of years so that if someone is here for 6 years, they actually get to go through all of the budgeting? Or what is the, what do you think about that idea?
Yeah, I think that's a good point. We looked at it in terms of how can you take this breadth of state programs that are state and local and try to get an analysis system and a review and evaluation system over a period of time. So we thought, at least every 10 years, you ought to be able to review everything. If you want to shorten that up, our thought on the member problem is that you've got a third of the turnover every 2 years, so you're always going to have people who are coming in and out of that system. But certainly shortening it would be fine.
Ms. Peek, follow up, Ms. Brownlee, then Ms.
Really, and term limits, none of us really even serve as a committee chair for the 6 years that we're here. You could hypothetically be chair of a committee for 6 years and never be up in the process for, when a budget comes up for the oversight piece of it.
Well, one would hope that, again, you're talking, our framework is, it's like the back to the Joint Audit Committee or the JLBC that has a broad enough range of members, and let's take education as the example, where in your first term, it's important enough to you to get that evaluation done for your committee policy purposes, so you'd have the joint committee put that item up earlier. So that scheduling is really up to the members to decide how it ought to operate.
Buchanan.
First of all, I to have a
performance-based budgeting system without a performance-based management system is, that doesn't make any sense, because you really can't have it at the state level if you're not implementing it at the agency level. The audit, to me, is not, doesn't, whether you do it every 6 years or 10 years, it doesn't mean that you're not getting the reports, the information, everything you need to make good budgeting decisions on an annual basis. And if you think you're having problems, there's no reason, I don't see why a budget chair couldn't request that an audit be done more frequently, particularly if you find that you're not meeting your performance objectives. But I think it's absolutely critical that we manage based on what our goals are, and we have some sort of metrics, because, you know, I think as someone, Ms. Standy brought up foster care as an example. How do you measure that? Well, it's not, you know, you, what you do is you say, you know, you're going to take a look at key metrics, whether how many are not getting their high school diploma, whatever you decide. I mean, the success of a system is not to eliminate a system, but to say, what can we do within this system to improve our outcomes and accomplish the goals we want to accomplish? And that requires agencies to manage differently and report to the legislature differently. And that reporting is going to happen every year, even though the audit, whether it's every 6 years or every 10 years, I would say I wouldn't start out overly ambitious, because we can always later on shorten it. But the audit is just sort of, it's another indicator to say, you know, the information they're giving us is correct and reasonable, and we are getting the information we need to make decisions.
You could have language that said no longer than every 10 years, leaving it open to be shortened.
Thank you. Mr. Bell.
I would propose if the program that is being evaluated involved local government or schools or something, that the joint committee set up a process like a work group or whatever to do a evaluation with the involvement of that particular local government or local governments, so that you can have more of a collaborative decision process with the local government, so everybody can come together and agree on some evaluation metrics. Because in a lot of cases, the local governments are making significant financial contributions to these programs, and the state will make a contribution, the local governments will make a contributions. Sometimes the local government's making far larger contributions than the state in many cases in a lot of these programs. The state will provide 10% of the funds. You find the local governments provide a much higher percentage of the funds. And I think in those cases, you have to really, if you're going to do some kind of program evaluation, there should be some form of involvement, collaboration, which might mean the joint committee would then create some kind of body, maybe a joint review committee with the counties, the school districts, city governments, whatever, or some kind of process. Maybe you can discuss how that would be done. If it was done by just a department that just involved just the state government by itself, you can just, you know, work with the departments. But I think it's important to collaborate, involve the, get some joint consensus on the part of local government when you do these evaluations. I would suggest that as a possible look at this in terms of this legislation.
One other, in terms of performance management, how has it worked in other states? I mean, I know the witnesses are familiar with that, but are there some good examples of that they want to share?
So yes, some states actually have a session that they adjourn to. The state of New Mexico, they have a time for legislation, budgeting, and the rest of it, and then they adjourn that session and they convene an oversight session. We looked at that and thought that was an interesting tool, because then if you did this in the summer and fall, you could then take the effect of that oversight and hand that to the administration that would help them understand your views for the preparation of the budget. I don't want to drive Mark out of the room here, but basically that means that through an oversight function that you did in the fall, in an oversight session, you could then at the end of that, through by resolution or how whatever device you wanted to use, hand that to the executive branch so that they would understand what your priorities are in the preparation of the next year's budget for both the budget and the succeeding year. So you get into a cycle And I, the reason I mentioned New Mexico is that they had a separate session for it. State of Texas uses a different model, where they have a sunset review system. Their model's different. Again, every states have different models given their traditions. But I thought the one closest to this concept was the state of New Mexico.
Actually, that may be a good segue to our third issue on budget information. And Mr. Fuhrer, if you would.
Yeah, very, very concisely. I know the hour is late. This element requires, as we really mentioned earlier, the governor would have to submit annually a proposed budget for the following year, and projections of revenues and expenditures for the successive 3 years. The point of which is, and some other information as well, an infrastructure plan for 5 years, it's about giving the legislature meaningful, long-term data to help guide our decision-making so we're not lurching from one short-term crisis to another, but rather fully informed as we make this approach. And as I say, it's kind of a, and Mr. Berryhill talked about two-year budgeting, it's kind of a, it's a meaningful step in that direction without going to a model under which we would end up making decisions that would likely change radically because the budget figures do change more frequently than every 2 years. Yeah, that's exactly right. So anyway, that's what this is. It's about information and infusing long-term thinking into our process.
Mm-hmm. Along those lines, a couple specific things. Would it make more sense to have the reporting date at some point after the chaptering of the budget rather than on October 15th, the date that's stipulated in the bill?
Let me comment on that. Currently, you get two budget updates, basically. You get one in January, and then you get one in May. The governor produces a document following the signing of the budget. What we've suggested here is that certainly the January information is important, as is May, but then at a piece of the quarter, that is to say after July and August and September have occurred, then you get an update in the fall. There's one other piece here where we're expecting that the governor would indicate to you prior to taking up the budget what the fiscal balance is for the budget that you're taking up, because normally all you've got is the May revision behind you. And so there are really four points of information here. Again, January, May, and then the point at which you're taking up the what would be a conference report on the floor, you'd have an update then, and then in October. You get an update after the governor signed it. Finance publishes it. So you already have that. But we're looking at the effects of the economy as you move through time, and you don't currently have a document between the time the governor gives you the effect of what he or she signed and January. So it's a midpoint. That's what we're doing.
But the governor's report's not in the Constitution, and these others are. I mean, that seems like the most important one, because that's after he does his line item vetoes and all the rest, so we need to know after it's enrolled what the impact is going to be.
Okay, and that's fair. It's not in the Constitution. But since governors have been doing it for 50 years or so, we figured that was simply part of the general ongoing budgeting reporting requirement, but we can look at it in statute, perhaps.
Yeah. Another specific question on the government code, current, well, I guess we kind of covered that. Are there any other questions from the members?
Mark Hill, if I could comment on a few of the things that are in this portion of the proposal. Let me try to put it in context first. The administration has had, obviously, a long-term interest in budget reform, and their perspective is highly influenced by the history that we've all lived through recently, where we've had extremely volatile revenues. We've had an extremely volatile economy. The revenues are even more volatile than the economy. It makes it very difficult for any kind of budget plan to work, and it makes the size of the budget changes that you have to contemplate much larger than is most processes are designed for, and much larger, I might say, than most other states have had to deal with. We've been much more volatile than most states have had to deal with. Given that history, the governor's had several proposals on budget reform, with the notion of trying to create a much larger reserve, a reserve that's much more subject to some rules about when money goes in and when money comes out, to try to help even out these huge swings of up and down that we've had to deal with, so that more attention then can be focused on the kind of things that we're talking about today with program performance and not have to deal with, you know, huge ups and huge downs as being the driving force behind almost all of the budget decisions. So the governor is still very much in support of the kind of budget reform proposal that was incorporated into Prop 1A on the last ballot. The governor has also, you know, been very much interested in these California ideas, thinks they're worthy of consideration, that planning for the future and measuring performance, reviewing programs, and adopting multi-year fiscal plans, all of which we do to some extent, are all good things to consider and should be considered as part of this process. But I think one of the things that we note here is the impetus in the language that's before you today is all on the administration to do the work and propose things in January, and it does not provide the same kind of rules of the game for the legislature and other players in the fiscal process. We have the same rules are not required of initiative proponents, and they're not. The legislature is not required to adopt a two-year budget or a five-year plan. Although we have, as a practical matter, all been looking at five-year numbers for the last couple of budget cycles to try to get a handle on our out-year process, it hasn't been institutionalized and it hasn't been required. And I agree it's very difficult to do, having to, in fact, do a lot of those numbers. They're not easy to come by five-year projections, and by the time you're getting out 4 or 5 years, they may not be very accurate, but they're still very illustrative of the kind of out-year issues that you may be making by your current decisions. So we would, you know, urge consideration that if there's going to be rules about multi-year planning, that they should apply to the budget, not just to the administration. And in fact, if there is to be a real multi-year budget, then that makes even more important mid-cycle and mid-year budget adjustment processes. We do have Prop 58. It has worked at least to some extent, but the governor is still supportive of the kind of mid-year budget adjustment authority that actually was enacted but has not gone into operation because of it's tied to Prop 1A. So let me talk just a couple of seconds now about a couple of the other parts of the requirements on the governor's budget. The proposal in there is another proposal that's in there is to have an economic analysis performed on each major budget solution, or at least that's how we read the language. We don't think that's really practical. It's desirable, but there's no accepted economic modeling technique that would allow us to separately estimate the economic effects of each budget solution. We can tell you, we could do a dynamic analysis probably with some considerable amount of work on the entire budget proposal all put together, but to disaggregate each piece and say what's its individual effect, we don't know of a technique for doing that. So we think that language, frankly, isn't very achievable. We don't think we can actually do it. We understand the desire for it, and some sort of economic analysis may be something that we can do, but the discrete macroeconomic estimate for each individual tax proposal or budget proposal is not something that we think we can do very well. We have had the same issue come up on the tax side. There was, in fact, a state requirement for a while for us to do dynamic revenue analysis, macroeconomic analysis of all tax measures of over a certain size. We did that for several years. I think a lot of folks found the results somewhat disappointing. The reason they're often disappointing is because when we looked at those and the way those modeling techniques looked at those, it assumes a balanced budget. It assumes that you don't get a free good here, that if you cut taxes, then you have to cut spending. And that then means that there's less public sector activity, there's more private sector activity. The two tend to balance pretty close. The differences that we measured in that model were where there were better multipliers in one sector of the economy, where you get more turnover of the money, you get more subsidiary economic effects than maybe some other type of spending. The differentials there are not big, at least not the ones that we have the knowledge to be able to model. And so we're not sure that you're going to get results there that are meaningful enough. That mandate was allowed to expire, and we no longer do that. The only entity we know of in government now that's doing that at the state level is ARB. They're using it for AB 32 modeling. But, you know, again, there's some concern that the level of science there in doing this modeling and doing this kind of economic analysis is not far enough developed to really do that very well and then do it in a way that's going to really help you budget very much.
Thank you very much for testimony. Your members, any additional comments or questions? No? Before we close, I want to note for the record that Mr. Fuhrer has been able to stand while we've all been sitting in these plush, comfortable chairs during this discussion, he has been standing the whole time at the podium, and you know, kudos to you for that.
So only another 2 days to go for a filibuster to actually work.
Yes, yes. But I really appreciate the testimony of all the folks who've come out, and Mr. Fuhrer for leading us in this discussion. And you know, this is the first part of it. We've got many more hours to sort of really vet all of the intricacies of the California Forward proposal, and we're going to be back here early Monday. So we're keeping this going as quick as we can. I want to offer the vice chair a chance to say anything. And with that, we'll close this hearing and we'll take it up on Monday. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hearing is adjourned.